Hello, welcome to e-learning class of parasitology. Today we are starting the session of tissue nematode, and first in this is D. medinensis, which is also known as guinea worm. You must have heard the story which is depicted in the Bible that people in Israel were having problem of fiery serpents. If you can see here, the such creature, snake-like creature, is emerging out of the body of this, and that was removed by the Moses. It is popularly believed that this has a relation with our today's worm, that is guinea worm. We'll see how it happens. So the objective of today's sessions are: first, we'll see general features of this worm, its morphology, the life cycle of D. medinensis, pathogenicity of Dracunculus medinensis, its lab diagnosis. Guinea worm, which is the common name of this worm, and the scientific name is Dracunculus medinensis. The scientific name derived from two words. Dracon means it is derived from the dragon, and from the place Medina, the species name medinensis is derived. The common name guinea worm is derived from the African country. This is the worm. The Gujarati name, or the local name of this worm or the disease, was Varo. That is based on its characteristic shape, which is very thin and very long. So that is the local name, but popularly it is known as its common name, that is guinea worm. It is known to mankind since antiquity, almost eradicated from Southeast Asia, where it was prevalent earlier. It was even prevalent in India. Now we are free from this disease. We have eradicated this disease, but still it is endemic in few countries of Africa. So it is still there. It is not still eradicated in the entire world. So if we see the some part of Asia where it was prevalent in 1986, almost 20 countries were there, and of which India was one of the country. And in India, especially in the western region, so Rajasthan, Gujarat, some part of Maharashtra, these were the main states where it was highly prevalent. But now we are free from this disease, and still it is there in few countries of Africa. It is still there. If we see the morphology of adult worm, the habitat of this worm is it is found in the subcutaneous tissue of leg, arm, and the back. And the size, the female worm, which is commonly seen, is around 50 to 120 centimeter long and cylindrical. So it is very thin. If you see, it is hardly 1 centimeter of thickness, but length is very wide, almost 120 centimeter. And male would not be seen commonly, but it stays for some time after fertilization, it disappears. But it is much smaller than the female one. So that is the morphology of adult worm of this. The other morphological form is the larva. Because here you will not find the egg, which we have seen till now in the intestinal nematodes, because this worm is viviparous, so it gives birth to the larvae directly. So larvae has a typical shape, which is the anterior part of that larva would be thick and very slender tail. It is much smaller than the adult worm. It is 500 to 750 micrometer in size. That larva So that is the morphology of adult worm and the larva. If we see the life cycle of this worm, there are two hosts from which it passes its life cycle. The definitive host, where the adult worm would reside and where sexual reproduction would occur, is the human being. And the intermediate host is the cyclops, which is seen in the fresh water. So, and the infective form for the human being is the drinking of contaminated water. So water which is contaminated with cyclops is the cause of the infection. So if we see the life cycle in detail, so you have to think of two things. Human being is the definitive host, and the cyclops, which is found in the water, is the intermediate host. So how person would get infection? When person drinks water which contains such cyclops, would be required to transmit the infection. So if person filters water that would remove the cyclops, person would not get the infection. So if simple this larvae is there in the water which is devoid of cyclops, the infection would not continue. For continued infection, person has to drink water which is contaminated with this cyclops. So when that water is consumed by the person, then that cyclops enter in the stomach, where cyclops would be disintegrated in the stomach, and the larva which is there inside the cyclops would come out of the cyclops, and it would pierce the gastric mucosa and enters in the systemic circulation. From there, it would convert itself into male and the female adult worm, and finally, after fertilization, the gravid female would move towards subcutaneous tissue of the leg, where usually it would form a blister-like thing in the ankle, in the foot of that infected person, and from that would release, because it is viviparous, so it would release various larvae in the water. So this larva would wait for the cyclops, because it requires cyclops for its further development. Once it enters in the cyclops, it requires almost 21 days to become mature. During that process, it has to mold itself twice to become infective. So that is how that cyclops becomes infective, and when that person consumes it again, it would come. And that's how its cycle continues. So this is the exit form in the water. The blister, when person comes in the presence, in the skin, comes in the contact with water, this female worm would release the larvae. So this is how its cycle continues. Now we see the pathogenicity. What are the diseases produced, or the clinical manifestation produced by this worm? So, in pathogenicity, it is also known as recanculosis. Initially, there is no symptom. The symptom starts when the female, gravid female, starts migrating in the subcutaneous tissue. So, initial would be more of the like nausea, vomiting, yeah, urticarial rash, intense pruritus, more of the allergic symptoms. And when it reaches at the site, it forms a blister, which is very deadly, and which is very painful. And when person, that blister comes in contact with the water, it discharges the blister fluid, which is yellowish serous fluid, which contains the larva. that lesion may have the secondary bacterial infection also. So that is the pathogenic this worm. So here you can see the adult worm which is there in the subcutaneous tissue. You can see the morphology is clearly visible in this thing. The next thing you can see is the blister formation. This blister produces intense itching and pain, so patient tends to go to the water because it is having burning sensation. So to get rid of that burning sensation, patient is obviously go to water or put that foot in the water, and in that blister would break and worm would come out from the blister, and that is how that worm would discharge, ensure that its larvae water. So this is how that female worm would come out from the blister and release the larva. So foot is the most common site from which it would come out. Sometimes it may come out from the upper part of foot or some unusual places like chest in this case, or even this. So these are the unusual presentation, but most of the time it would come out of the foot, either from the metatarsal bones or from the ankle joint. These are the most common site from where the female worm would come out and release the larva. Now we are coming to lab diagnosis. How to diagnose this disease? Basically, the symptoms are self-diagnostic, but we can identify the adult and the embryos. Adult would come out and easily such adult worm could be found. This is the diagnostic. Or from the discharge fluid, you can find plenty of embryos which is discharged in the fluid. So that is the thing. There are intradermal tests available, which would be a hypersensitivity test. When you inject the this antigen, there would be hypersensitivity reaction. Radiology in X-ray, the female worm would be seen in the subcutaneous tissue. In CBC, you will find that there is a marked eosinophilia, which is a characteristic of any parasitic infection. Serology, you can go for ELISA and detect the antibodies against this thing. So these are the laboratory diagnosis. Treatment, there are two kind of treatment. One is the symptomatic, which is the initial treatment, which is with antihistamine, because initial, as we have seen in the clinical manifestation, that in initial phase there are allergic responses are there. So initially that is done, and then antiparasitic drug like metronidazole or nidazole can be given. But the age-old treatment of the extraction and removal of worm is the best technique. That is also done surgically. So carefully, that worm is tied with a wooden stick, like mat stick or some stick-like structure, and slowly it is rolled. Now, here slowly means it requires days of the extraction, because as you know that the worm is long, up to 120 centimeter, and hardly it would come 1 to 2 centimeter out from the body in an hour. So you have to be very patiently. When that worm comes out, slowly you have to roll it, and that entire extraction of the worm may require more than 10-15 days almost to remove entire worm, because if you do it fast, you will end up with the breaking of the worm at any point of this, and that worm would remain in the body. So for complete extraction, it is a very slow process, and you have to be very skillful and very patient to remove that, extract that entire worm. So that is the age-old treatment which is used. If we see the Indian story of guinea worm eradication, so the guinea worm eradication program, that is GWEP, was started in the 1983 and lasted up to 1996. During that, before that, India has many cases, almost 44,000 more than that cases in the 7 western states of India, it was common. And in 96, disease transmission was stopped, and WHO has certified India as a free from guinea worm in the year 2000. The main source of this worm in the India was man-made water collection, so fresh water ponds, so step well, where people go, people store the drinking water, and when cyclopes are there, when infected people steps into this, it would release the larvae, and that would be contaminate the cyclopes, and by drinking that water, there would be death. And in India, for example, in Gujarat, there was a slogan, which is a very simple slogan, which has contributed to eradication of that, is simple filtering of water. So that's how they say, because the name of disease is Waro, because it looks like a thin and slender, like Waro means a metal nail like thing. So they say Pani Gaaro Waro Taaro, means if you filter the water, you can get rid of this. And still it is there in the Africa, where there is a potable water is not available. People is drinking the water which is grossly contaminated, and that leads to the. And how to overcome this? Such filtration, because it is transmitted only if person drinks cyclops, and cyclops is a quite big thing. So with simple filtration with a cotton or any mesh would remove the cyclops, and or such straws are available in the Africa, which has a, on one side there is a filter, so directly they drink water through this. On the lower end there is a filter, so in this contaminated water, if cyclops is there, it would not enter in the person. So basically, if we provide the potable water, this. So in the summary, two things you have to remember. One is the life cycle. Life cycle is the very simple, two hosts are there. Definitive host is human being, and intermediate host is cyclops, and person would get infection by the drinking the water which contains the cyclops. Mere simple filtration of water could make your water safe to drink, and this disease can be easily overcome. The other thing which you have to remember is the extraction of worm, because that has a historical importance, and it is an age-old technique, but still it is the only way to get rid of this worm. So slowly you have to extract the worm, which lasts for few days. So if you see this logo of WHO, there is a stick and there is a serpent. It is derived from the Greek god Asclepius. But many believe that this logo is related with the removal of the guinea worm, because there is a stick and there is an intervened worm. So that's all for today's lecture. Thank you for hearing this lecture. If you have any query, you can write in the comment box. Thank you.